at full forward.
Rockcliffe, gee, that was strong by Rockcliffe. That is a terrific goal.
Fantasia or Fantasia?
Roaming Arazio.
Arazio Fantasia!
I wonder how far we've got to go back to see when time on was allowed for a pig on the ground.
Welcome to Rock the Razbah, episode 16. Unfortunately, we've lost a co-host today. Arazio could not make it, so we've called in a substitute. His name is Daniel Norton, the GM of media at the Port Adelaide Football Club, affectionately known around the playing group as a car salesman and the music festival man. Daniel Norton, welcome to the hosting chair.
Well, it's a huge honour. Massive shoes to fill. And where is Raz, by the way? Is it just some sort of sniffle or just a prior engagement? Any idea where
he
is?
I don't think he likes coming in, so he's given us the arse and he's out of here.
Has he done anything all year?
He has. You can follow that up with him. I bring it up every week about him only having to co-host. How are you, Daniel?
Really well, thank you. And seriously, a pleasure to be here, normally working behind the scenes, sort of organising everything for you guys. But now on the other side, just for this week, looking forward to filling in. And a huge guest.
Yeah,
how good's this?
Terry Dactyl, still waiting for his jumper that you promised him in round Terry one. Dactyl. So put that down. Of course, we do have a huge guest off the back of his best friend and sleepover buddy, Zach Butters. Last week, we have Mitch Georgiades in the house.
Thanks for having me on board, boys.
Wow.
Now, Mitch, you're only 20 years old still, played 44 games, booted 58 goals, and had about 17 mark of the year contenders.
Yeah, 44 games has gone pretty quick, actually, in the last 20 bit years. It's been good fun. Didn't really enjoy it.
I was at your first game, round one, 2020, Gold Coast. Empty stadium, Metricon Stadium.
Yeah, that was weird, wasn't
it? That was weird. Talk us through that, because I was actually in a media box with your family because they could get in just, that was just before the complete lockdown, but we were playing in front of nobody. Tell us about debuting in front of an empty crowd.
Yeah, that was weird. So obviously I got told on the Tuesday of that week that I'd be playing, and early on during the week I was told that my parents wouldn't be able to come because there was obviously no one going to be there. And it wasn't till the Friday, I think we played on the Saturday, that they got told that they'd only be allowed to come, just mum and dad. And just sit up in the media box, which was pretty weird. So, it was a bit of a different vibe. Like, you don't really expect your first AFL game to be in front of zero people. Like, you've played pretty much every game in your life in front of more people than that. So, to have that was pretty weird. But I remember it was a bit of a weird sight walking off. We won, which was awesome. And just seeing mum and dad, the only people in the stand, clapping above, which was pretty... It was cool to have, but it was a bit different to what it is now, so definitely happy we've got crowds back.
Now, let's go back to when you were a young fella. You're the son of John. He played 103 games for Subiaco, but I assume that's where your love of footy came from?
Yeah. Dad obviously played a fair bit of footy growing up. Was lucky enough to go over and play for Western Bulldogs for a bit and had a bit of a debut, actually, where he kicked 8 on debut. So he does remind me fair all day. The time that 2's not quite good enough as compared to 8, so... he's been obviously a massive part, along with my mum, in terms of my footy career and getting off the bat. So he's always been there, which is good.
Your family's been really important to you. You grew up in WA, moving away. Talk us through your junior footy days, how that all functioned. I think your grandparents were really important as well in your footy journey.
Yeah, so obviously dad and mum, really important, and grew up playing a lot of my sport at school. I was lucky enough to go to Hale School in WA, which is a really nice school, and they prioritise sport a lot, which is good. So I grew up playing lots of sports, footy, cricket in the summer, athletics. I did a fair bit of athletics early days, and then I sort of had to make the choice whether it was cricket or footy, and I sort of stuck with footy, which is something I always was leaning towards. So it was amazing growing up and doing a bit of everything, but definitely happy stuck with footy.
You still follow the cricket, like, in summer, and you're still very passionate follower of the game?
Yeah, absolutely. It's something probably not so much in winter. In winter, I sort of lose the love for it, but as soon as summer comes back, I'm the biggest advocate. So
the weather gets warm, the buzz around.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly right.
So cricket in summer. I want to talk about school. You said you played a lot of sport at school, but you were very good at school as well. You ended up with a 97 or something on your year 12?
Yeah. Somehow got brains. I don't know where from. Not really mum or dad, so Sorry to mum, sorry to dad. But yeah, I don't know. It's sort of something I've always been sort of naturally gifted with, a bit of brains, and I've had to work hard. It's probably a bit of a gift, not a bit of a gift, bit of a blessing in disguise that I was actually injured in my 18th year during my draft year, which was year 12. So it meant I could buckle down at school and fully concentrate on that and put all my effort into that, which is something I take a lot of pride in and something my parents both push me towards heavily, even now that we're playing footy, to make sure I've got something on the sideline, which, yeah, something I continue to keep push.
So what was your year 12 score?
Yeah, it was about 97.
97?
Yeah.
Oh, come on. Has anyone actually seen the certificate? Have you seen anyone seen this?
I find it just not believable that he scored 97. I don't think you and me combined for 97 with both our scores, but I want to give you a bit of insight because I've spoken often on different stuff about Mitch Georgiades, how book smart he is, but street smart, he's just not there at all. So he walked in today and he said to me, the first thing he said to me when we were standing outside, gee, it's cold. What do you think he's wearing? He's got shorts on.
And I think he had a tank top on as well before that.
Middle of winter.
Unbelievable. And what are you doing?
There is another story I want to touch on today because...
Before you say the story, I just want to make sure that everyone knows it's not true.
I spoke about it on radio. We spoke about it when Mitch has not quite got everything right. And there was a day out here at Alberton Oval. We warmed up and we go... You know what a warm-up takes? It takes about 20, 25 minutes. Yeah. We go through the whole thing. We kick balls together. We do everything and... We run back into the huddle, have a drink, swap some jumpers over if you have to, and Mitch has looked down and realised that his boots are on the wrong feet.
No. No, Mitch. What, right on left and left on right?
I just don't know where he's got this from.
True story.
True story. Told it on radio. We'll get some audio to overlay there, but yeah, it's certainly true.
I've got nothing for that. It's absolutely not true. I'm sure like there's not a single person in the world that could do that.
Well, you just don't know. Well, apparently it's been done and by you. Now, just before we finish up with your education background, what's your go-to subject? Is it chemistry? Is it physics? Is it mathematics? English?
I was more mathematical orientated. I was never very good at writing stories or English sort of side. So for me, it was all math sort of stuff. But I do love the economics, the finance, that sort of industry. And that's probably where I see myself beyond footy, going into that sort of world. So, yeah.
Is that because you love money?
Yeah.
And because your family's loaded? Yachts everywhere. But moving on to your footy journey now, you ended up pick 18. You spoke about that injury in your draft year. That was a bad quad?
Yeah, bad quad. So in the, what was it, that All-Star games that you play as an underager before the grand final and the curtain raiser, I got a little cork in. I didn't really think of anything of it. And then a couple months later, I was actually doing my 1 week experience at AFL club, and I was walking across the oval one morning and it just literally blew up straight away. It was like a mountain, genuine mountain on my thigh. Yeah. And I spoke to the doctors and I was pretty much straight to hospital. And yeah, I ended up having three operations trying to get rid of it. Coil put in one of my arteries or veins or something like that. So, yeah, it was a bit of a weird experience and it put me out for 12 months comfortably, and it wasn't really until I got to Port Adelaide here that I was actually started to get proper moving again. Yeah, and
that's remarkable. So a corky, from a corky, you've missed a year of football.
Yep.
As you know, like you've done an ACL or an Achilles or something. From a corky, I mean, we've all had corkies playing footy, and they are sore. But if you miss one game, you know, you sort of get a little bit ridiculed for it, but that's nasty. Remember Jaron Gehry? Was it the St Kilda captain who had his operation where he had to have his opened up? I mean, that is awful.
Yeah, it was pretty, it was very uncomfortable. I remember just like the initial pain of when it, so it must have, there's the initial corky calcified and it turned into sort of like a bone structure. And then that must have flicked a vessel and then all of a sudden it's just bled into my quad. And that's the same sort of thing the Gehry had, where it's sort of that compartment syndrome.
Yeah, nasty.
It just builds up pressure, and it was, the initial pain was horrendous.
I think Gavin Wenganine had a similar problem years ago when he played and had have it opened up. So you've got no residual issues with it now?
No. All good.
Brilliant.
Moving on now, you got to Port Adelaide, and you haven't had any injury concerns at all. You've been a really consistent performer through your journey. Have you always been a high flyer?
Yeah, it's probably something I've always done. It probably relates back to my athletics a bit, where I used to love the jumps, the high jumps, the long jump, the triple jump a fair bit. So It's just the way I've always played. I've enjoyed that part of the game. It's, I think, a great spectacle of what we do. And being able to take a couple is always nice as well. But I don't think Charlie's too happy sometimes with me. And Toddy on the weekend. Sorry, Toddy.
We've taken three hangers, I think, in the last year from memory. The one at Adelaide Oval last year against Melbourne under lights, I think on a Thursday night. One about a month ago against Frio. And one on the weekend against Geelong. What's been your favourite out of those three so far for Port Adelaide? Because they've all been very similar.
Oh.
And they've been beauties.
I think my best one was probably the Freo one.
Yeah.
But it, I did have a little bit of excitement when I turned around the weekend and saw it was Todd's head. So that also just adds a little bit to it. So
now, been nominated for Mark of the Week too, again. For Port Adelaide, so we're up against a couple. We're up against Adam Sard from Carlton, of course, Toby Green as well. So we've got our work cut out, but we need Port Adelaide supporters and members to get behind Mitchie's mark for this week.
We speak about your flying as being one of your great strengths, but also your running ability is another one of them. You're often in the front group pushing Carl Amon, Travis Boak. Is that something you've had to work on, or always been a good runner as well?
It's probably something that I've also been a little bit naturally gifted with. In terms of my athletic ability, but it's something I've definitely made an emphasis to work on. I was always a reasonable runner, but in terms of, I knew once I started getting to this level, you have to become the best of the best. And it's something, I'm not the largest bloke for the position I play, so it's all about making the most of the other things that I do have, and something that I can do is run a bit more than some of my opponents, and trying to take that to the next level, and yeah.
Do you see yourself venturing up further up the field as well? Your strengths complement that forward line at the moment. There's four talls, potentially. You're a medium size. Are you the link player that can get up and down the ground?
Yeah, definitely. I think that's something I've been working towards in the last couple of years, in terms of being able to become more versatile and be able to get up the ground a bit more and use my assets and my legs. And that's for me just improving other aspects of my game, my skills, my knowledge of the game. And that's something I continue to build. Trying to work on with Nathan Bassett. So, definitely along in the future, I think that's somewhere where I can improve myself.
There's one thing you have to do, make sure you get your boots on the right feet.
That's true. Now, we like to know what makes you tick away from the game, of course. You know, you've spoken about your passion for business and study. Who are you living with at the moment? What's going on there in your life?
Yeah, so I'm currently living with Ryan Burton and his missus, Bree. And I've been there for almost 2 years now, and absolutely loving it. So, we get on really well. I think Bree must get sick of us a fair bit of the time. But I've been really enjoying that.
Now, you've got this bromance or relationship with Zach Butters. Obviously, Birdo would get a bit jealous with the amount of time you're spending with Zach. Talk us through that, because you guys together are the biggest pests. We did this video a couple of years ago, or last year for Photo Day, and you, that day, we mic'd you up. Oh, my God. What a pest. Now, what's Buttsy like, and who eggs each other on, you or him, or him to you?
Buttsy's a good kid. He's
a good kid.
He means well. I don't know. It's sort of, I don't know how it sort of like started. I don't think early days he gave me a whole lot.
No shock there.
Yeah.
Crickets. Gave you nothing.
Yeah, roses in particular as well. None of them really gave me a whole lot. So I sort of had to wheeze my way in there and use my charm. So... It's like, we sort of just like this last probably year and a half, we sort of got really close, and we just get each other. We're like he's probably said, we're pretty happy-go-lucky sort of guys. Like, we're just having a bit of fun, we egg each other on, and I think we sort of rely on each other to drive the energy, in this young boy. So we have a fair bit of fun, and I think Wall and some of the older boys get pretty sick of us, but we're not going anywhere.
Harry and Lloyd, Dumb and Dumber, they complement each other really well. We spoke about that last week in a great visual that the media team put together. What's your greatest prank that you two have pulled off?
Greatest prank? We actually did this to Connor a couple of weeks ago. So we knew there's Connor, Dylan Williams and Sam Hayes and Ollie Lord were all at Connor's playing a game of PlayStation that we knew they'd been playing for a while. And they're playing like one where it takes a couple of hours to get to the top level, and we knew they were pretty close to the top level. Anyway, so me and Zach went around to their house. It was probably 8:30 at night, 9 o'clock at night. Snuck around the side of the house and turned off the power.
Gone, lights
all
out.
All the power, lights out. they come out the front like, what's going on? So we're hiding around the corner with like lemons and stuff. And so when they come out, we're begging lemons at them.
So he's been working his backside off to get to this point.
Yeah, all four of them.
In this game.
The disappointment when they walked out of the front of the house. And it's like someone had been shot. It was terrible.
Lights out.
And to compliment it, it was just a couple of lemons in their head as well.
And you tried to do something similar at Ollie Wines' house. You tried to go around there and break in, but he's got cameras and caught you in the act.
I actually wasn't a part of that scheme. I did see the videos and, yeah, it was quite obvious who it was, but yeah.
So you're very book smart. What are you studying at uni, just for the listeners out there?
I'm doing a Bachelor of Commerce. I'm ticking over slowly. I've been doing one subject, but I think I'm going to start picking up another one soon. I think Dad and Mum are pretty keen on me to speed up a little bit.
And your days off, you like to be outdoors. You're a keen golfer, quite good at it?
I wouldn't say quite good. I'm not too bad, but yeah, I do love my golf. I play a fair bit with Ryan and down at Royal Adelaide, which is really nice. But yeah, we get out a fair bit, which is good.
What's your handicap?
I'm about 8.5.
So pretty handy golfer.
Now, Rock and I like to consume a little bit of gin as well, particularly in the summer months. Old McDonald's gin. What is this? I did a bit of research. Is this a family business?
Yeah, so recently Mum and her partner, John, have started up this gin business, and it's been keeping them really busy and they've been really enjoying it. So it's something that we've got a property about 45 minutes to an hour out of Perth, and we run the gin distillery off that. And it's been keeping them really busy, and they're doing a lot better than I think they thought they were going to do. So it's selling in Adelaide, it's selling in all places around Australia, and they've recently done there was a big fire in around our town in the eastern parts of Perth. So they recently did this gin. It's called the Firefighters Gin, which is obviously in honour of them, of the firefighters, and I think the donations went towards them. So yeah, it was. It's a really good initiative, and I think, it's keeping Mum busy, which is happy.
Haven't seen my bottle yet come through. there's no transaction.
No free stuff that gets around. I know Stevie Motlop has a gin that gets handed out quite frequently. Also, the Hey Diddle Wine gets a pass around and whatnot from the boys at businesses.
But thanks, Mitch.
Thanks for that, Mitch. We'll move on to some fans' questions now. So we'll just get Norts to pull up a couple there. But I'll start off the top. Jake Pacini wants to know why you are the worst person at the club at golf.
That is so raw coming from him. He's without the doubt the worst player at the club right now. He's gone backwards. Obviously, he's had an ACL injury, which doesn't help. But he started recently playing again, and I think it's probably time to throw the cue in the rack.
The number 19, Dueno _06. Why did you choose that? Or was that number just provided to you when you started?
The initial numbers that we had was 14, 19, 27 or 34, something like that. So I didn't get the first pick because obviously Miles Bergman was the first pick in my draft. So he picked 14.
Well, and in order. It goes in hierarchical order.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's the way it works. So... And then I've always grown up playing with the number 9. So yep. I thought the best thing then was 19. And I've played with that number a couple of times in the past when 9's been taken.
Is it true that you just have no awareness, self-awareness? We speak about this a lot with you, that you're just a little bit not bright. You went to Robbie Gray and said, can I wear number 9 when you first got to the club?
Oh, no. No, not.
No, I don't think I'd have the audacity to say that.
Hey, Rob, do you mind if I can pass over the 9?
You can have 19, I'll take 9.
Who would you rather in their prime? I don't mind this question. Rock or Raz? Amy O'Leary.
I don't want to say you because you're here. But some of the early pig status wasn't too bad. I used to do my dream team a fair bit of help, so I'll lock that in.
Got one here from Elizabeth Gray, who says... Is that wouldn't no relation to Robbie? You wouldn't have thought. What's the feeling like though, Mitch, when you step onto Adelaide Oval and the crowd is absolutely roaring? I mean, take us through that third quarter, for example, on Saturday night, where it was just heaving. The crowd was in excess of 30,000, very loud. What's it like out there?
Yeah, there's nothing really you can explain that does it justice. I think when you get on a roll, it's like when Charlie kicked a couple goals and. Just the roar, the full, you can feel everyone's emotions and it sort of just drives you. Like, you can't you have no option but just like to keep going. Like it's just unbelievable. So it's probably one of the best feelings you can have, and you can't replicate it anywhere else.
Originally, when we started playing at Adelaide Oval, and there was crowds before COVID of 40 to 45, 50, and you would have played in some of these massive showdowns, it was actually hard to hear. They said like the crowd was so loud that it was hard to hear. So I imagine there's a you've almost got to train for that as well, to try and keep your focus and your energy level sort of balanced, but then just trying to communicate must be hard sometimes.
Yeah, it is. I think Rock would agree. It's, I think one of my first games I played at Adelaide Oval when the big crowds were back was against Richmond. And there was one like this. I just couldn't hear like anything. Couldn't hear the whistles. Like there was, I think Pep had it in the pocket. They blew a whistle. I had no idea what was going on. Like it's just, you just sort of just like, what is happening? Yeah, it is about trying to like keep your emotions just at check as well, but so you don't get too carried away.
It's often funny because at home you hear the umpires clear as a whistle through the microphones that they've got, like you hear everything, but when you're at ground level you just can't hear it because the crowd is so loud. And that's why we love the Alberton crowd, when they particularly when they turn up at big home games, which we've got a home showdown coming up as well, which we'll talk about later with the draw released earlier this week. Now, are you a big music listener before games? Power Jules 5555 wants to know, what's your favourite music before a game?
I've got a bit of a weird thing that I listen to before games. So my granddad's song, like, used to be my granddad's favourite song, and I always used to listen to that the last song before I like turn off all my music, and just like, that's the last song I listen to. It's a song by Engelbert Humperdinck. It's a real old song. I have no idea.
Humperdinck?
Yeah. It's The Last Waltz. I don't know how it started when he sort of passed away, and I sort of want to live on it. Like, he's meant so much to my footy, so I wanted to live that on, and just like sort of the last sort of second when I come back in from the outside warm up, just have like 3 minutes to myself where I just big breaths, and just like slow everything down and just, yeah, take it back to him. So
we'll just take a bit of a quick listen maybe to that audio. Just have a quick listen to
la 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 la.
So that is an old song.
Yeah, it's an old song. It's a bit of a different song to like, doesn't quite get pumped up. It just sort of gets me, just relaxes me back a bit. Just think about things that, I don't know, he used to say to me, and just gets me in a good place to go out there before. Obviously, then when we go down to the training, the music ramps back up on the warm-up. So, yeah, it's just a 3 minutes I have myself before.
And it makes you feel connected with your grandfather?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's very special. Yeah.
It's very important that you don't get overhyped and he gets to a happy place and can go out there and perform his role to the best of his ability. So we will. That's where we'll wrap it up, Mitch. Thanks very much for joining us. We've had a bit of fun here, taking the mickey out of you a little bit, but your story's incredible. You're injured throughout your last year. You went to school, scored the high points there, and also we love you in a Port Adelaide jumper. So thanks again, and make sure you get your boots on the right feet this week.
Thanks, boys. Thanks for having me.
Welcome back. How good was Mitch Georgiades, Daniel?
I'll tell you what, impressive, impressive lad. Athletic, can take hangers, can kick goals, and smarts. And he feels like he's got himself set up. I'm giving him more credit than what we all thought that he might have struggled the elevator getting to the top level, but he's actually gone okay.
He certainly struggles a little bit with that. Anyone that can warm up and have their boots on the wrong feet.
I cannot believe that.
He won't acknowledge it and admit to it, but he certainly did that. It was incredible that day out here at Alberton. But let's move on to the footy now. Port Adelaide took on Geelong, unfortunately went down. A seesawing affair in the end, because at halftime, absolutely gone, out on their feet, and then all of a sudden the third quarter was stunning. Best footy that we've played all year.
Probably the best quarter of footy we've played in you know, arguably two or three seasons. I mean, 8-1 against the top of the table, hard and strong, informed Geelong was phenomenal. I think what the reality does suggest is that the club and the list and the program is good enough. It's just not good enough for long enough at the moment. And, you know, everyone internally has acknowledged that. It's just a matter of getting that form consistent across 120 minutes of the game.
Yeah, unfortunately, it's just been the Port Adelaide playbook this year, hasn't it? We've given up a big lead, chased it back down, and then fallen just short. It's happened three or four times this year.
Some stats. I mean, we've lost 7 games by 14 points or less now, which tells you there is a capability there. It's just closing out those big moments. And, you know, you've played a lot of footy and you'd understand that. You draw your way back within a goal or two and then the opposition just kicks a steady and we end up losing by that very, very small margin, which is not good enough, but something that, you know, the team has to consider and develop. But you can see we're nearly there.
History tells you that will always even out. So last year, I think we went 5-0 with those close wins. And this year, unfortunately, we haven't been able to win those close ones. So over a three-year period, I think they all even out. Unfortunately, this year for Port Adelaide, it just hasn't gone our way. And those close defeats will eventually hurt us.
What I will say, though, is this group has got so much to get out of the next month. You know, assuming that... Well, not assuming that the next month is the end. You just never know what can happen in football. I mean, mathematically, it's really, really difficult for the group. The odds are stacked against us in terms of finals, but I know how intensely focused this group is on this Saturday afternoon against Collingwood. So much to play for. Big club, MCG, they're the most informed side. So look out for a big day there. And also, two of our current champions playing their 200th game, Ollie Wines, Tom Jonas. I mean, tell us about those two players.
Well, I was going to get to that. I was going to wrap up the Magpies versus Central's first. They were good and won by 23 points, but you've skipped ahead there. So, yeah, of course, they take on Collingwood at 1:15 p.m. MCG this Saturday afternoon. Yeah, huge game for the footy club. I think Tom and Ollie have been great leaders of the football club for a period of time now, Tom being the captain and Ollie vice-captain. But they mean so much, and they've led from the front really well. Ollie obviously winning a Brownlow medal, but I thought Tommy Jonas on Saturday night was the one that actually turned the game around. There was a number of players that did it, but he had a few big contests in the opening minutes of that third quarter and got the momentum back in Port Adelaide's favour. So it was really good, and wish those boys all the best in their 200th game. They played their 150th together. Now they play their 200th together. And also the Magpies take on Sturt at Sturt's home ground at 2:10. On Saturday afternoon as well. And also a little bit of AFLW news.
That's actually the following Saturday, which I know there's a bye this week, which is fine, but for the competition. But next Saturday, August the 6th, Port Adelaide travel to Unley to take on the Double Blues. You're aware of that, I understand, and you're just getting a little ahead of yourself.
I'm getting a bit excited because...
I know you are.
Off the back of a win, I think they can win again. But AFLW voting, they're actually voting for captain at the moment. So watch your space for an announcement there.
Yeah, I mean, we've got some wonderful candidates. When you think about, you know, football royalty, there's Aaron Phillips, obviously. There's Ange Foley, who's a wonderful leader, has come, you know, from the Adelaide Football Club. Gemma Houghton, who's 28 years of age, great experience coming from Fremantle. And there's a whole range of other leaders who sit within that program. So really interesting. I think the club will announce that early next week. So keep an eye on that. Who's going to wear the famous number one Guernsey for the first time in Port Adelaide's AFLW program?
Well, my tip would be Erin Phillips. I think she's a perfect fit. Older head amongst a younger group. I think she's perfect for the first couple of years of the competition. But we'll watch your space, see who that is. Now, we've seen earlier this week that the showdown slot has been announced.
Yes.
Round 23, 7 p.m. Saturday night, Adelaide Oval.
Our home game, Port Adelaide's home game, our preferred time slot. Our members and supporters love it. Look, who knows where both sides will be on the ladder at that point in time. But what we do know, it doesn't matter where either side is on the ladder. You've played in many showdowns, Rock. I think you battled a little bit in your showdown history. You didn't get a lot of the pull, but hopefully, which is true. But hopefully,
that's factually incorrect. I should have won 4 showdown medals. I think we went over this one day. We certainly have somewhere else. I think I had 43, 38, 36, 35. So you can do the numbers on that and come back to me next week.
You can. Well, no, enough about you. This coming showdown in round 23 will be huge. Tickets will go on sale very, very soon. And we would love to see a massive crowd there because Regardless, they are such an important game for both clubs, but particularly for us here at Port Adelaide.
Now, moving on to Friday Night Footy, brought to you by our great friends at KFC here. Do you want to wear the bucket hat for this segment?
Yeah, I'll wear the bucket hat.
Now,
on my bonds.
We did have a bet last week, but there is no challenge to take place this week because, unfortunately, it was a draw.
So it was too.
There was no
Richmond Fremantle.
No loser on that game because we didn't pick a margin. We just thought that there'd be a result one way or the other.
Do you never assume, Rock? When you did that last week, I'm thinking pick a margin, man, because it's closest to pin. But a draw it was, a draw it was. So we look ahead to tomorrow night, Fremantle hosting Melbourne.
What happened to your voice?
Well, I got a bit of Bill Laurie there. I'm carrying a throat ache.
Fremantle take on Melbourne, of course, over there at Optus Stadium. I'm going to tip Fremantle. I don't think Melbourne are going that well at the moment. I'm going to tip Fremantle by 15 points.
No, you're missing the psychology around footy here. I thought you'd be better than this. Where was the location where Melbourne won their prelim last year? Where was the location where they won the grand final? They're heading back to Optus Stadium. They feel comfortable. It's great memories. They will absolutely thump Fremantle.
Thump them. How much?
They're going back to a place where they feel at home with great memories. 37 points.
37 points. I'm going to write that down.
I'm doing that for Raz. Bad luck, Raz.
Melbourne by 37 points. So
they're back.
So the margin doesn't matter, of course, unless there's a draw.
Correct.
Because I've gone for Fremantle and you have gone for Melbourne for Orazio. So that's Friday Night Footy brought to you by KFC.
Also tomorrow night, a big shout out to our man Kyle. Kyle, Com Games start tomorrow night over there in Birmingham. I'm not completely across the swimming fixture, but I know he'll be in the pool very, very soon. So our man Kyle, all the best. We might need to check in with the great man when he's back.
He will be swimming on Saturday, so the event Saturday morning our time. So Blockbuster, make sure you tune in. I think it is potentially the qualifying or maybe even the final. We know that swimming gets underway really quickly in the Commonwealth Games. So we wish him all the best.
What about Cody? Big Cody Simpson's taken your Speedo deals off you. He has signed up as a lifelong ambassador for Speedo's bikinis. Now, after your swimming performance a couple of weeks ago.
We don't like to talk about Cody. Kyle's our man.
Thank you.
So, we'll just be moving on there. Daniel, you've touched a soft spot there for Kyle. Hopefully, we apologise for Daniel Norton performance there. But were you not happy with my swimming performance? I'd be more concerned about Orazio's swimming.
Happy with your swimming performance. Wasn't happy with the size 28 Speedos being nearly lost within the glutes. What were you wearing?
Well, that was a stitch up. You sent your little counterpart, little Lucas, mate, your little lap
dog. You're not dog, in Rio, mate. You're not on the beach.
To go and get these Speedos. Brazil. And I said, I'll probably need 36s now that I'm retired. I used to get in the 32s. I said, I'll probably need 36s. And he's bought back 28s. They were riding up my butt cheeks, and there's no doubt about that. But that's a wrap for the show.
No, it's not. We got a couple of more things to get through.
Okay.
You're pulling on the boots this week.
Oh.
Don't think you can get away with it that easy, Box Hill style. What are you doing?
Well, again, this is what I told you about Mitch before. So Mitch told you I was playing this week at Box Hill. I told him a minute before that it's Broken Hill. Up in Broken Hill. Broken Hill.
Box Hill.
Broken Hill this Saturday.
Mitch.
Saturday afternoon. So I'll go up there, do my local show, radio show up there from my hotel room, go out, have a kick, and then I've got a sportsman's function the next day.
Bit of cabbage?
Just a little bit of, no, just for the love of it. Daniel, you know what I'm like. I come in to do this podcast for free. So as long as they have a KFC zinger box there for me after the game, then I'll be very happy. And a few pirate lofts, of course, as well.
You're an honest man. I know you have mirrors at home, and you're not fit. You're rotund.
Yes.
Have you trained at all? Is there any risk of... we've seen Luke Hodge come back and do these things for other organisations, and he had a compound fracture of the finger. Any risk that you're going to rip a hamstring off the bone? What are you doing to prepare?
I'm worried about my hands. I'll show you for the visual listeners out there. My hands aren't great. Like, I can't close that finger there, so there's a potential that one could. That one, as you can see there, is just hanging by a thread down there. So the fingers are concerning. I think I'll slot into a full forward pocket type role and just try and get a couple of kicks. It's a top four clash. So
it's a decent comp up there.
Yeah, so North are sitting second on the ladder, and we take on, I'm not sure who we take on, but they're fourth on the ladder. So it's a top four clash. It'll be huge for the town. So hopefully everyone can get along. So I'll sign a few autographs for the kids, take a few pictures. I must admit, there is only four teams in the competition.
So you're getting, let me get this right, you're getting paid $5,000 to play. Some young kid's missing out now because you're squeezing into full forward, being the look at me, the big sheriff in town, riding in on your horse.
That's factually not correct what I'm getting paid. So just be careful about that figure that you throw around. But I was going up for the sportsman's function. They do a pass players up there, which I was going to do on the Sunday. And they inquired to ask if I would be interested in playing on the Saturday. I said, well, if I'm not taking anyone's spot, then I'm happy to turn up and play and put on a bit of a show. And I'll be no good. To be fair, Dinkum, I'm probably carrying 13 kilos heavier than my playing days, which the last time I played...
30, did you say?
13. The last time I played was actually out here at Alban Oval when I went up for that spoil and ended my career when I had it on a string against Woodville out here.
Yeah.
That was the last time I played, which was around May last year, I think. So... looking forward to getting back out there and having a bit of fun. So that should be good fun, Daniel. Yes, that's for sure.
One final thing to leave you with. Now, come on. You tell me you've got more connections than Telstra. You tell me that I can ring this guy and I can get him on. I can ring this one. BT, I want an update on Brian Taylor. Mate, you're in the commentary box with him. In fact, let's throw to this audio now. And this is what BT had to say about our podcast, your podcast, a few weeks ago.
I know that podcasts are a thing of the current and future. Just a little bit of news rattling through at the moment. Here's McCartan.
Hello.
And, there's a podcast called Rock the Razbah.
Yeah. I've heard of it.
Oh, no.
Now.
Settle, Brian. Settle.
Rock the Razbah.
Yeah, that's true,
which
bro.
Has eked out 10 episodes, JB.
They got shut down for a few weeks.
Hold, it's about to be axed permanently. And our man Rock is the rock part of the Razbah.
A little razzle dazzle
arrives.
Yeah.
The name is better than the show.
He was pretty brutal on it, wasn't he? He certainly did not miss the podcast and said that it was on its final legs, which potentially at one point during the season it was.
Probably still is.
On its way, but you've pulled it back and we're starting to just build up. And he said that he'd come on. You spoke to him privately after that week. I sent you the audio and you spoke to him.
And he said, look... Yes, Daniel, I'm a little bit shocked. In fact, he rang me back because he didn't actually know who I was, the number. That's why he rang me back. He's gone, who is this? And what are you talking about? And what podcast is this? And I said, BT, this is, and, you know, Rocky and all that sort of thing. He said, okay, I've got no idea what you're talking about, but I'm willing to come on in a few weeks. I've since texted him, rang him with you the other day, crickets, got some staff to speak to him up at Alice Springs Airport when he was commentating for Channel
and
7.
And what did he say to them?
I have no idea what you're talking about, but I do know of a Daniel Norton, and he is very, very, very forward. Well, BT, if you think I'm forward, mate, I'm about to ring you one more time. This is our last bid to try and get Brian Taylor on. Shall we call him now?
Yeah, call him now.
Give him
a call
now.
On. He said he'd come on the podcast. Here we go. Couple of rings.
Come on, Brian. Brian.
You're very forward. You gave him great access in roaming Brian. When he used to do that.
Oh, he was willing to...
He loved Port Adelaide, but he since...
Hi, the person you have called is not available.
Of course he's not.
Please leave a short 10-second...
You'll leave a message for me this time.
...and we'll send the message as a text.
Brian, Daniel Norton here. It's about time you came on the podcast. We've reached out several times. You said you'd come on, and now you're not going to. Come on, Brian.
That was actually...
Hang
it. Thanks very much. So I was about to say that was Tom Rockcliffe and I didn't get my words into it. Who actually thinks it is me?
He will. So, it'll go through as a text message.
Brian, I know you. I know he does watch the show and he does download it. I know. Please, mate, we want to get you on before the end of the year. We've got a few weeks still to go. And maybe we can implore our loyal followers and listeners to hit him up online on any way they possibly can on socials to get Brian Taylor on Rock and Raz, maybe episode 18.
Episode 18. So
because next week we've got Ollie Wines.
Got Ollie Wines fresh off his game 200. And of course, I'll just refresh that for the listeners out there. Port Adelaide take on Collingwood Football Club, 1:15 p.m. MCG, Saturday afternoon. The sample has a bye. And also next week, the AFLW will announce their captain. The voting will be completed and there will be an announcement from Port Adelaide who the AFLW captain is.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We'll give you an update on how we go with Brian. Looking forward to hopefully Raz somehow... returns in some capacity next week. I'm not sure in what capacity. It'd just be good to see him at the club in some shape or form.
He returned last week and played a pretty good game, so he could potentially go into the senior team this week. But good luck, Raz. Hope you get off your deathbed, mate. It's a shame you're not here today. I've had to put up with Daniel Norton. But thanks again for tuning in. This is Rock the Razbah.